Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Throughout history, many have been considered to be great. I didn't even realize how many great people there were. I looked it up, and I saw a whole list. You know some of them, like Alexander the Great, and Peter the Great, and Ivan the Great, and Ramses the Great, and Cyrus the Great, and Herod the Great. And the list is like that long of all of these individuals that have had that attached to their name, the Great. Many, many more. But even some sports figures have donned that title as well. Remember Wayne Gretzky? His nickname was the Great One. Muhammad Ali, boxing champion, he labeled himself the greatest. Personally, as far as boxers are concerned, I've had this argument with people over the years and everything. In my lifetime, he was the greatest to me. But as far as boxers are concerned. I don't know that it helped him as in his life there. But even in going back to my childhood, we were talking about this a little bit earlier down in the prayer room, even Tony the Tiger said of his Frosted Flakes, they're great. And so it is a description that people like to attach to all kinds of things. But then again, this is what the angel Gabriel said about Jesus. He told his mother, this child is going to be great. I mean, think about it at the moment. She would say, well, you know, there's a lot of, she's probably in her mind, some of the greats of her lifetime and recorded in her history. And she probably said, well, yeah, my little Jesus, he's going to be great, huh? Little did she know how great he would ultimately be. He clearly is the greatest of all time. I want to give you several things that he is great at. I mean, let's face it. It's in Luke chapter 1, the angel does not say what he would be great in, just said he'll be great. And almost anything, and believe me, my list could go on, but for the sake of the message tonight, I've chosen some things that I find him to be very great in. The first one being this, he is the great God. He is the great God in his being. Just think about everything that God did. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I mean, no limitations, all powerful, all knowing, omnipresent. Think about it. He is great in that sense. No limitations whatsoever. In Titus 2 in verse 13, the Bible said, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Even God in his word considers God to be great. I never heard anyone talk about great Allah or great Buddha. But I know that Titus 2:13 calls him the great God. And by the way, in that text, it's referring to Jesus Christ. And so Jesus Christ is God. It doesn't matter what the cult say about him. If they don't believe that he's God, then they're the ones missing the mark here. But Jesus Christ is God. And don't let any Jehovah's Witness or Mormon tell you any differently. He is very God in the flesh. You say, how do you know that? 1 Timothy 3:16 tells us. He says, and without controversy. There's no controversy on my part. I don't argue with anyone about it. You don't want to believe that. Help yourself. But he said, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. God was manifest in the flesh. He was made known in the flesh. Well, who could he have been? Who, pray tell, could God have been in the flesh? I'll tell you who he was. He was Jesus Christ. He was justified in the Spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. If you search the Scriptures, I think you'll conclude that that was Jesus. Jesus is very God this evening. And so he's the great God in his being. He's great. I wonder, in the mind of Mary, if she could have even begun to know at that time that that little babe that she was going to bring into this world was literally going to be God. Let alone that she would have the responsibility, yea, even the privilege of raising this child. In my mind, and I know it's silly, but I always try to envision Mary and Joseph getting in their little SUV and driving down to Walmart, and they're there, and they encounter, whoever over in the toy aisle, because every kid, Jesus included, probably went right for the toys. And while they were talking, they say, how's little Jesus? They say, oh, he's perfect. he's absolutely perfect. He doesn't sass you back. No. Everything he says is just wonderful. He does everything right. I mean, think about it. Just, tell you what, our God, there's a chorus. I remember hearing it over the years. Our God is an awesome God. He's not awesome. He's great. He's great. And every time I say that, I sound like I'm doing a Frosted Flakes commercial. But the reality is, God said, the angel declared to Mary, he shall be great. Notice, he didn't say he might be great. He is great. So he's the great God in his being. Secondly, he's the great God in his love. He's great when it comes to love. Think about it, folks. No one's ever loved us like the God of the Bible. No one. In Ephesians 2:4, the Bible said, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. Not just any old love, great love. John 3:16, for God so loved. Notice how he inserted that little so. Didn't have to. He could have just simply said, for God loved the world, but he so loved. I'll tell you, he did more than anyone before or after him. In John 15 and verse 12 to 14, Jesus said of this, he said, this is my commandment, that you love one another, even as I have loved you. He said, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. He said, ye are my friends, if you do whatsoever I command you. So the greatest demonstration of love is for someone to lay down his life for his friends. And imagine Jesus calling sinners friends, but he did. And so he's a great God. He's a great God in his being, but he's also a great God in his love. I'm glad that his love, I've heard some crazy things over the years where people say, well, God so loved. Oh, that's past tense. He doesn't love the world anymore. He loved the world at one time. Oh yeah, I can understand that now, because we're so much more lovable today than they were 2,000 years ago. Yeah, right. And I'm reminded that 2,000 years before that, or even more, God destroyed the whole earth. Destroyed the living creatures on the earth. So something mixed up with the love there. No, God loves his creation, and God loves you, and he loves me. And if he ever stopped loving us, our mere existence, the mere fact that we breathe air, would be sufficient enough for him to pull a plug on us and call it quits. But I'm glad he's great in his being. I'm glad that he's great in his love. Number three, let me say that he's great for his salvation that he offered. I've thought about this many times, and you think about all the religions of the world, and every single one of them, every single one has a list of do's or don'ts. They dump the responsibility upon you. You must do this and this and this and this. And then maybe you might get it. And whatever you do, don't do this and this and this and this, or you'll never get it. And yet, God's salvation is, let's see, this will really pull the wool over their eyes. How about if I just give it to you as a free gift? There's no way we would ever think up that kind of salvation. In Hebrews 2 and verse 3, the Bible says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Even God says, you know, the salvation that I'm giving to you, that's great. You can't get a better deal. We've never seen a better deal than that. Jonah 2:9 says that salvation is of the Lord, or at least the kind that works, the kind that you can rest in, the kind that you can have the peace of God which passeth all understanding. That's the kind that God gives. Well, I'll tell you, he's great. I've never heard a greater, not that I would, I mean, I'm satisfied. What God did for me satisfied my soul. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. I've rested in it. For 30 plus years, I've been resting in the finished work of Jesus Christ. No one's ever came along and offered anything any better than that. But when I heard this, it's the best news I ever heard. I'd heard some other things, you know, what other religions offered. You know, if you do this, you do that, you know, you could have this. Some said, well, how's this for an encouraging thing? If you don't really do well this time around, you could be reincarnated and come back and get to do it again. Oh, yeah, yes, please. Keep that cycle going till I get it right. Yeah, let me sign up for that one. No, I like God's. God's was absolutely perfect. How about if I just give it to you? Thank you, Lord. I'll receive that. The Bible said in Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other. For there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. So to me, he said, neither is there salvation. So the best kind of salvation, the greatest kind of salvation, the only kind of salvation that will ever work for anyone is the kind that God gave us. And yet people still, they still poo-poo that. And they say, well, you know, I know he did that, but now watch me. Like they say, watch me, God, watch this. Titus 2:11 says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. So for anybody that wants to say, well, I never knew that, or I never saw that, or I never had a shot, not according to God. God said, the grace of God that bringeth salvation, his salvation, the great salvation, hath appeared to all men. Everybody's had a shot. Everybody could get it. What a great God. What a great God. He shall be great. And we start going down the list and say, yeah, he's a great God. And nobody's ever seen any kind of love to surpass that. Think about this for a second. Think about all the times thus far since you've been saved that you've been a stinker. Did God lower the boom on you? Did he kick you out of the family? Did he kill you dead? No, he didn't. Does that happen in some family circles? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Not with God, though. He's great in his salvation. I've never sought any other because the kind that God offered, the kind that I received, the kind that I currently, presently possess is a very great one. And I have no desire for any other one. Number four, he's great for his gracious mercy. Think about how merciful God has been to us. Before salvation, yea, even after salvation. He shows himself to be kind and merciful to us over and over and over again. Aren't we all guilty, honestly, guilty of doing the same thing? The sin which does so easily besets us. We do it over and over and over again. You know, in this life, you know what parents say to children to do that? If I told you once, I told you twice. Imagine how many times God would have to say that to us. And yet, we keep showing up and he's merciful to us again. Psalm 103 and verse 10 to 12. He hath not dealt with us after our sins. Aren't you glad of that? Nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Psalm 145 and verse 8 says, the Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. And I have taxed his great mercy. I know I have. And yet, I'm not trying to. I'm not trying to push him over the edge. But I know that I've brought him to a place where he's given me a double take. Didn't I just deal with you about this? I know, Lord. I know. Numbers 14:18 said, the Lord is long-suffering and of great mercy, forgiving iniquity and transgression. Yeah. Not just the little incidentals of life, the oops, the oh, I slipped, the biggies. The biggies. He still cares. He still cares. You know that I go to the jail, and I'll tell you, some of the guys that are there, many of them are facing some long sentences. And yet the only thing that really kind of keeps them going is the fact that God is still merciful to them, that he hasn't written them off, that they still have a shot. Well, I'll tell you, folks, if we ever get to the place where God's mercy runs out on us, we're in a real bind. Number five, he's great. He's great in his power. Think about it. There's nothing that he cannot do. Oh, some fools have said, you know, can God make something so heavy he couldn't pick it up? Yes. Yes, he could. See, I'll get the answers for all of these things that puzzle the theologians. Not that I'm a great one, but I know something about God. Could he? Absolutely, because there is no limiting factor in God. So could he? Yes, he could. But he wouldn't, because it would now violate his nature. If he's all-powerful, then he has to be able to do anything. But if it's going to violate his nature, then he won't do it. What a God! He can do anything he wants. How many of us can make that claim? We're such a limited bunch, and yet there's nothing that God can't do. Jesus Christ, while standing on the earth in the form of flesh, could say to a man dead 4 days, Lazarus, come forth. And a dead man gets up and walks out. By the way, correct myself, he didn't walk out. He just, like, floated out. Psalm 147 and verse 5 said, great is our Lord and of great power. His understanding is infinite. There's nothing that God can't do. I just happened upon some kind of program. I don't even know what it was. Great Mysteries or something like that. And they were talking about the medical things. And they were talking to doctors. And one doctor said, years ago, he said, I would have dismissed this whole thing about prayer and all of that. That was nothing. Of course, most doctors pride themselves in their abilities, their medical abilities to pinpoint, diagnose something wrong with someone, treat them, and, you know, see them out the door. But they were talking about this one doctor said that he had been practicing for over 40 years, and his experience has shown him that people who had the finest medical treatment and all fared a certain way, but others who had the same treatment but had the, either through themselves or other supportive networks, family, friends, churches that prayed for them, they fared better. Yeah. Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of them. I'll tell you what, folks, I love this verse in Jeremiah 32:17. It says, "Ah, Lord God!" Exclamation point. We could stop right there and just, I mean, all of the things of life that if you just threw God into the equation, you'd have to say, ah, Lord God. But he said, "Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee." You know what makes us conclude that? We see all of the things that he's done. We've read about them. We've heard personal testimonies about them. And you have to conclude his power is limitless. Matter of fact, Jesus said in Matthew 28:18, "All power is given unto me in heaven and on earth." And so, number five, he's great for his power. Number six, let me say, he's great for his ability to shed light. James said it like this. He said, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given unto them." Isaiah 9:2 said, "The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light." We sing the song, "I saw the light, I saw the light." Yeah, I did. If our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. David said, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Everywhere God goes, Jesus said, "I am the light. I am the light," he said. "He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life." Man, if you want your way illuminated, if you want to find guidance and direction, then go to God. Go to God. Go to his word. In John 1 and verse 8 and 9, the Bible said, "He was not that light." Speaking of John the Baptist, he was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was Jesus, that God was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Not only is his salvation available to every man, but God will grant guidance and direction to everyone as well. Number seven, and finally, let me say, he's a great God, because he will be, as far as leadership and governance, he will be the great king. Oh, he's seated on a throne right now, but his kingdom, as he said, "My kingdom is not now of this world," but it will be. Oh boy, it's gonna be. And all of the governments that are trying to, look at what's going on in our country right now, it is sad. It is sad to see the constant, endless bickering between our so-called beneficial two-party system. It's pathetic is what it is. Boy, if only Jesus could come back and take the throne, straighten it all out. Psalm 48 and verse 1 and 2 said, "Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. In the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness, beautiful for situation is the joy of the whole earth. is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. The city of the great king. Psalm 95 in verse 2 and 3 said, let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great king above all gods. People are looking for the next great world leader to come along. Who will it be? I'll tell you who it will be. It'll be Jesus Christ. Now that's not going to go over big with a lot of folk, but I'm looking forward to it. I sure am looking forward to it. In 1 Timothy 6, Paul writing to him said in verse 13 to 15, I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Christ Jesus, whom before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, he's coming. He said he was. Which in his times he shall show who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. Now, here's Paul talking to Timothy about this future time when Jesus Christ, the only potentate, the only one worth anything, worth praising and bragging on, but when he comes back, he will come back as the King of kings and Lord of lords. And lo and behold, John takes a little trip into the future. And he sees this, the Lord told him, write this down. And we've got it in our Bible. We can read it in Revelation 19 and verse 11 to 16. John said, I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. The song says, the next time he comes, there won't be a Calvary. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him with upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress and fear of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, all capitals, King of kings and Lord of lords. Mary watching everything that he ever did, and thinking as she watched that, thinking, the angel said, he shall be great. That was great. That was great. And just marveling over it. She knew, and I'll guarantee you, Mary never one time said, that's my boy. No. She knew that one was a cut above anything this world has ever seen. Let me give you a final verse here. In Psalm 145 and verse 3, the Bible said, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent,